exhibition that's going on upstairs in the South Gallery on visual illusions. And we've always been calling them optical illusions, but apparently they're called visual illusions because of their full difference than just optical. I've chosen to pick out 28 works from 1930 to 1939, because I thought, well, I talk about, you know, his double images and not talk about the ones that you're familiar with in the collection that you've either heard on a tour or, you know, tour yourself on. So I picked out 28 and I concentrated on the 1930s because otherwise we'd be here for several hours probably talking about those way into the classic period where he did a lot of double images and double visual illusions in his later works. I'm going to get used to this thing. Water, and the hands are made up of what appears to be globians.
Jughead of the female as a receptacle, and we've seen that before in his works, and then there's what appears to be like a horse-like figure in the background. Here we have a collection of individuals that are called the butterfly group, and we've seen them in drawings, and some man and a woman together with a child, though, and they have kind of an erotic connotation to them, and he's holding like this butterfly net. Here we have the Gradita type figures that he used repeatedly, and their female organs seem to be replaced with roses. And this may relate to what happened to Dalí at this time, is that she had a hysterectomy and had female problems at the time and had a hysterectomy. So he often depicts women with that, either represent genitalia, labia, or, you know, vulvas having a hysterectomy. So that painting is one of the early ones of this period. An invisible sleeping woman, horse, and lion. He did several renditions of this. We found a link to Romano's painting or etching of the fight of the body of dead Patroclus here. You can see this figure here. And then head's back, and the arms are kind of laying over. Well, you see it better probably in the next interpretation where you have that figure actually depicted here. And it becomes, either it's a horse or a woman, and the tail becomes kind of a lion-like, and then we have the ball again. So he depicts these things in a landscape, but then he puts them on some sort of platform, either a tabletop or some sort of slab of concrete or whatever this is here, and it becomes entirely kind of a different kind of image. There's also another interpretation utilizing that. So he's kept on working this idea of the horse woman. And I don't know if it was entirely successful, but many of them are interesting. And this, of course, is a very erotic combination of figures in this particular interpretation of the horse woman with boats in the distance. One of my favorite is the phantom cart. Just so subtle. There was another, about three of these that he did that was working out this idea of the phantom cart, where you have the cart in the distance on the Amsterdam plane. The silhouette of distant towers read as occupants sitting in the cart right here. And the amphora in this particular one, they don't all have that. It's at Yale University. The back. This is the one the foundation just purchased. This doesn't have amphora in it, but it depicts that Amsterdam with the, you know, little village in the distance. And here's like a church-like tower over here, and you can see it a little better here. And I found a picture that I'll show you in minutes that have to do with that. So we have that, and Dalí was intrigued by the special pleasure produced by the slow metamorphosis of shapes of clouds and slow moving landscapes. And in one of the books I was reading, and Dawn Adams wrote about it, Dalí would go around in the rowboat with the fishermen around there, the animal and the camel, and these are the rock formations of Cape Creus, and you go, one fisherman said, oh, you know, one minute it's a woman's body, and the next minute it's a rooster. So, you know, these shapes would transform depending on what angle you were looking at. So this was kind of tied into that changing shape. Here we have another view, here, but not with some of the rock formations of the area surrounding it, and then again, the cart is depicted here, and then you have the fancy Carolinetta, who died of tuberculosis, and so became sort of a specter type image on these, walking across these landscapes. So it's kind of a haunting apparition that you would often include in these types of paintings. And then we have sort of bean shape up here. And here's a picture of Gala and Dalí together, but we have that church that appeared in the distance in this painting. I chose this because the specter of the Angelus is one I've never seen too often. It's been in a private collection. But I'm picking on, I picked it out because it had to do with the clouds and seeing double images in clouds. And Dalí apparently saw, very similar to our Japanese mannequin, done in 1934, this was done the same year. The man and woman facing each other are the Angelus figures, the female and the man. And then you have Napoleon, and of course Dalí, as you remember, wrote his autobiography, The Secret Life. At seven, I wanted to be Napoleon, so the depiction of Napoleon. But this elongated shape, deformed, relates back to also the Charles Maldoror, which was another thing he illustrated, where he misshapen the figures. He had these kind of bony protrusions and things supported by crutches and that kind of thing. Another very famous work of this is Paranoid Face. Very strong work. It's in a private collection. So, you know, it's rare that we get a chance to see these sometimes. This one, you can see here, in its original configuration, is figures seated outside of a hut. And then it's surrounded by foliage around it and the landscape in the distance. Then, if you turn it up on end, you see the face, the eyes, the nose, the mouth, the chin, and the hair. And Breton thought it looked like Marquis de Sade. Here it was written about in a surrealism, in the Surface of the Revolution in 1931, where the depiction of the head here in the kind of the original photograph of the this. Where the figures are sitting outside a hut. This was what actually inspired Dalí. And then his interpretations of it here in developing the double image. And he said that he explained the technique after a study. This is what he went through when he saw this. After a study, when I was obsessed in a deep reflection on Picasso's face, in particular those of the Black period or the African period, I looked for an address in a pile of papers, and suddenly I saw myself altered by the reproduction of a face I believe corresponded to Picasso, a face absolutely unknown. Suddenly this face disappeared and I realized the illusion. So I imagine we've all done that, where we see one thing and it's actually another thing. So this was what inspired him to do the Paranoid Face. Paranoid Critical Solitude, done in 1935. During this period, he established thematic analogies through the repetition of morphologically similar objects. An Nancy Carr covered in the overgrowth of flowers is depicted here in the foreground. And this Nancy Carr, sort of a Model T, is seen in one of our paintings, also at the bottom, where it was abandoned on the beach, and Dalí has, and he also did the Raining Taxi, a lot of Raining Taxi in our store, and he's invested, and he put flowers around it, and then you have the opening and you're looking through. Then the other repetition, where it becomes sort of a silhouette impressed on the rock of that Model T, and this image, this puzzle shape, which would fit into there, it comes three-dimensional and comes out. You as a block that's attached to the wall. So he's playing, you know, these kind of visual tricks on you as you look at his works. And they're all very fascinating. Another favorite of mine, I remember seeing
early on, was the suburbs of apparently a critical town, afternoon in the outskirts of European history. Well, that time, usually it just goes by the suburbs of paranoid critical town. Now this is again where images kind of transfer from shape to shape. And it started out with Gala holding a handful of grapes. And let me go to the next little drawing. And here she is holding those grapes. And the grapes seem to transform into the rear end of a horse. And then the horse, this shape, the skull of a horse, comes out of that. So you have all these shapes kind of being generated by a bunch of grapes. And apparently, Dalí was eating these grapes and was very sensual to Dalí, and he wanted to record that little instance. Well, we should point out, oops, I'll go back. Okay, there's several things in this painting to look for. And this is a day of seeing, and not actually knowing the meaning, but will transfer through these images. Okay, we got Gala holding the grapes, and then we have the horse up on like a pedestal, almost like it's a sculpture of some sort. And then down here you have the head, face or the skull of the horse, flesh removed, and then you have an amphora again. Type of shape, which from the Greco-Roman ruins not far from where Dalí grew up, would often wash up on the beaches. And so we often include this little image in some of these paintings. Then as you go here, you see this is sort of like a dresser with a mirror. And a little top piece here, bottles on the top, and then the drawers open, and then you have this shape here, which reminisces, the whole thing is reminiscent of this shape up here, which is a sort of building with high pillars, and it mimics the same shape. And you have figures standing up here mimicking the bottles on the bureau. And then you have a chair, it looks like somebody's been sitting in it, but then these clothed and cloaked shapes here sort of mimic that chair. As you go over here, Dalí, we have a drawing in the collection called Nostalgic Echo. It was a study for Hugues Pradjadet, which was a book that was published in the early 30s, but it was depicted here. You have a hole going through here, and it's repeated. So you look through here and you see the bell tower and the bell. Figure in the tower is indicative of this figure here, which is the little girl of innocence skipping rope. So those are repeated images. And then you have this little walkway, probably in the town of Port-Laudat, on these little narrow alleyways. In the distance, there's a figure standing in this doorway. And then you have the nightstand, which is used in some other works, and the keyhole mimics the figure down in the distance. And he does it again with the doorway here mimicking the keyhole here. So there's all these kind of images that go on, and it's almost like a puzzle to be put together. Where they are. The Great Paranoia, 1935. In the mid-30s, Dalí began to orchestrate multiple figures with technical assurance. So he kept experimenting in the landscape and beach and a lot of mass figures in the foreground forms the face. Now some, you know, we don't train in this, so some of us, in some cases, can find the faces pretty easy. Here is the face of Paranoid, and the figure here, the woman, becomes the nose, the lips, the cheekbones, and then there's a figure standing here. You can see this male figure here. But sometimes, you know, these figures disappear and come back to make up these faces, and then there's a figure standing here, which makes up the opposite side of the nose, the eye, cheekbone. So he subtly assembles these figures in such an interesting way that these images appear. And then this part becomes the hair, which is sort of a gathering of figures again. And then in the distance, he does it again with the same kind of composition, but the hair becomes, it's sort of like all of a sudden all these people decided they wanted to leave. And so while they were leaving, the hair becomes almost, you know, kind of a freight wig type of thing. It's all sticking out. People are walking away. And then there's the whole figure of the distance. So we were very subtle but intriguing. Head of a woman, which has the form of a bat. And in our collection, we have the Paranoia. And it's very similar to this, where you have the face. And then years later, he does a painting called Spain in 1938, where he uses the same kind of configuration. As in the previous slide, Dalí could almost be illustrating Leonardo's instructions to look into the stains of walls, or ashes of fire, or clouds, or mud, or like places in which you may find really marvelous ideas. So here we have this little landscape, and you go from positive to negative shapes to create these illusions. You have a figure kind of walking away here, and then another figure here. Now the figure here, with her hands kind of outstretched, make up the lips. But then this figure kind of walking away makes up the nose. And then the figure on the horse back make up the eyes. And then the hair is the battling and warring figures, which also Leonardo referred to, that you can see these types of things in the warring figures are depicted in the background. Premonition of the paranoid perspective for the soft structures. And this is something we don't see this painting too often. In the foreground, you have these figures that are repetitious of a figure in another painting, but it's a child and looks like a man and a woman conversing with this man who seems to be hollering, yelling or something. And then he depicts them again in the configuration of figures in the background. Group of figures here kind of represent this face. So it's sort of like these are metamorphosing into faces. As they move together, these figures, they form these faces. And then in the distance again, one of these faces appears as these figures of, it's usually combines figures of, figures on horseback, figures skipping rope, female figures usually, or figures walking on the beach. So all of them kind of are displayed on this sort of vast landscape of Amsterdam. Geological Justice, 1936. Kind of interesting, it was, in 1936 it was shown, and it was listed in the catalog with a different type of title, but in September 1970, Dalí entitled the work Geological Justice with the following explanation, which I thought was kind of odd. It was a type of figure landscape on the ground, both arms crushed and open. And I'm like looking at it, and it doesn't look like a figure laying on the ground, crushed and opened. It looks like a maybe carts and things broke down here. But again, it's this expansive Amsterdam plain. And it was painted in Port Lagat and showed up in another Rotterdam exhibition. This looks like sort of a priest-like figure, you know, with a large brim hat or some sort of figure. And then this almost looks like a figure, but it may not be. So it kind of goes back and forth from these kind of hidden little things around the edge to sort of add perspective to what's before us. But it was odd that it was interpreted this way. Average Pagan Landscape, 1937. It was basically during this time he was spending a lot of time traveling to, you know, to Italy and Rome and those areas. And so some of his works take on a different influence. Here we have figures again standing on the beach, the girl skipping a rope, figures standing together, the nursemaid sitting here with a little boy, like from our weaning over at Furniture Nutrition. Then you have two figures here, one seated, another one laying down.
from a painting, this figure laying down is from the morphological echo in our collection. Then you have a figure on horseback. Then three figures standing here, one pointing up, and then there's a head here, which at first you might not see at all. And it sort of becomes part of this cliff. See the eyes, the mouth, the nose. Maybe Freud, I don't know. I don't have an interpretation for who that face is and who that head is. But again, it's sort of that hidden visual illusion where, you know, it looks like a regular landscape until you add something that is puzzling. Okay. Swan's Reflecting Elephant, 1937, a very wonderful work. The swans in the lake create a double image. The swans with the trees behind create the reflection of elephants. There has been speculation that the man standing to the left in the portrait is Dalí's benefactor, Edward James. And it was during World War II that this work was looted by the German army occupying France and was kept in storage in the Jeu de Paume Museum in Paris from 1940 to 1944. Some of Edward James's works that he owned did end up in that situation. Go back to look at closer again. There you see the cliffs and the rocky, the craggy rocks of Cape Creus. You see a little landscape in the distance of the boat. But the predominant image, of course, is the swans that are here, and then the elephants that are here, and then you have the trees going up. Trees that become unreflected, kind of cuts off part of them here, and then it's reflected in the pond down here. So that's how he creates his double image. And then there's a strange shape over here, which I'm not sure if it's some sort of metamorphosis flower or two swans copulating, I'm not sure, but it's a strange thing going on there. And then even the clouds themselves, they remind me of almost figure-like, or almost Thomas Hart Benton-like, or what, but he is always interested in, you'll notice that he doesn't only have his landscapes, but he also has some beautiful skyscapes. Metamorphosis of Narcissus, 1937, Tate Modern. We had this displayed at the museum many, many years ago at the old museum, and it's a pretty fascinating work. In Greek mythology, Narcissus was a youth who fell in love with his own image and drowned when he tried to embrace his own image in a pond. One noticed that the limbs on the left of the painting belong to the figure looking into and being reflected in the pond. Right there. So you have the Narcissus looking at himself in a pond here. And it's kind of here, it's here. And next to him in these kind of almost very rigid fingers, the image is depicted with it holding an egg with a narcissus blossom coming out of it. And here he is, Narcissus on a pedestal. And also, by the way, in the distance, there's another repetition of this figure holding this egg. And we have a dog that seems to be gnawing on something down here. And why, I don't know why that's there, but it's depicted there. But then in the background you have this sort of grouping of female figures and male figures together. It seems like though Narcissus has no need for that because he is so in love with himself in the pond, so these types of figures are not important to him. When Dalí visited Freud in 1938, he showed this painting to him. Freud remarked, "That is not the unconscious I see in your paintings, but the conscious." Invention of the monsters. That's a note pad here. He painted this while he was at a ski resort in Semmering Mountains in the Austrian Alps, and it was towards the end of the Spanish Civil War. So I think there's a lot of things in this painting and also in the Inventions of Africa
his terror and the things that are going on with what's going on around him, the Civil War. So there's some very interesting images in this painting, and it's very asymmetrical because it's sort of unbalanced. One side is very heavy on images, the other side is pretty vacant. Though there used to be a blue dog in this painting that apparently whatever paint that he used, it was fugitive and it disappeared over the years. So some of the earlier works of this, you can see the blue dog. But let's point out some of the images. You can see here a burning giraffe and burning figures, probably, you know, things are going on surrounding the Spanish Civil War. Down here in the foreground, we have figures, and I'm going to go to another slide so you can see them better. But here again, we have the repetition of the horses, the woman horse, appearing in a group up here. Okay, this is a close-up of two areas in the painting that are significant. You have here this hand kind of reaching in that we're not sure is really the figure here, the symbol and figure with the hollow eyes. They're supposed to be sort of fortune tellers or prophesizing figures. And so that's what this represents. And again, it's a figure here with the nose coming down, but then this figure next to it that's looking in the other direction. One figure is a profile, and the other is a frontal view. But as they mesh together, it becomes a very unusual portrait. She's holding an hourglass and a butterfly. The hourglass, of course, relates to the idea of mortality, death, time running out. And then you have the butterfly figure, which has to do with metamorphosis or beauty or things changing. So those are the two hands, and they may be talking about relating to other things that have to do with this painting and the war. And then Gala and Dalí are sitting here, and this is a beautiful portrait of Gala looking sideways next to her husband, Dalí, looking at us, and done with quite a bit of detail. And on the foreground in the draped the table is the hand from Metamorphosis of Narcissus, a loaf of bread, which could be Dalí. And then you have this sort of sculpture that also is depicted with the double face, you know, the side face and the front face. That might be Dalí's, not Picasso, possibly, you know, the different angles of the faces. And then off in the center of the painting is again the angel. And this cat-type figure with their faces meshing together, and then there's a nice profile of a woman here, and then there's this horse right next to her, so the horse's face becomes the woman's face in a sense. So, and it's kind of frightening. She has this sort of skeleton-like hand, so, and I guess it ties in with the horses that we saw earlier. So go back and just look at it again, and they're all kind of on these pedestals. And the dog, if it was there, it would be in this area here. Okay, when the Chicago Art Institute bought this in 1943, Dalí sent the following telegram. I'm pleased and honored by your acquisition. According to Notre Dame, the apparition of the monsters presages the outbreak of war. Horse, woman, equal maternal river monsters. Flaming giraffe equals masculine I don't think I can pronounce it. Apocalyptic. Nope. Help me with that. Yeah, thank you. Monsters. And cat angel equals divine heterosexual monster. Hourglass equals metaphysical monster. And Gala and Dalí equals sentimental monster. The little blue dog is not a true monster. They're curator. That message tells me a lot. Okay, Spain, done in 1938. This is the full-length allegorical figure of a woman. Takes shape on the Apennine plain. You can see it here. It's the figure. And Dawn has remarks that the palm trees, the arcaded buildings in the background, and the line suggests rather North Africa. The Spanish Civil War had begun with an invasion of Spain by Franco's troops from the African colonies. And of course, there are other relationships to that and in this painting. Because you have a lion or a tiger or something here, which you wouldn't find exactly in Spain. The woman's posture, drapery, and tilted head give her a classical appearance, while the nightstand is detailed as her arm. So you can see the nightstand has great detail and so is her arm. But this is more the image is kind of fading in and out. Her face is made up of boring figures. We'll look at that closer in a second. And then there's two figures on horseback here that are their heads becoming her nipples, and they're having a fight with lances. Have some close-ups here. Of course, the inspiration for the woman in the painting came from a print that used to hang in Dalí's bedroom for years. You can see it's just reversed, this figure here. Of course, you have the lion's head appearing here. And you can see the figure a little clearer. And then another image of a close-up of the face. And here we see it, it's depicted here again, where we have a figure standing here, walking away. Like that earlier one, this is the nose and the arms outstretched from the mouth. And this is the eyes over here, and the boring figures become the hair. Image disappears, 1938, based on Dalí's long-standing passion for the Dutch artist Vermeer. The girl is reading a letter. It's in profile, so identify that here's the nose, the eye, sort of the mustache shape of the arm, the letter, and then the dress down here. His hair pulled back and makes up this not very pleasing face, if you ask me. And then the background is the wall with a map on it and the chipboard floor, very reminiscent of Vermeer. And I had been reading also that they found a lot of books. They thought that Dalí may have taken this a little further. This was like in the late 30s, so because they found a lot of books on Vermeer where he had been working out ideas with Vermeerian pictures to produce more double image works like this. And we figured it was probably based on this, or when a blue reading a letter because of the Apparition of the Face and Fruit Dish on a Beach, 1938. This is a wonderful work. It says it was at the Athenaeum. If you get up there, you should go and see it. It's really wonderful. And of course, the main figure in this is the fruit dish on what appears like a tabletop. So you have the landscape and you have a tabletop. There's still life, and the dog is pictured here, the rear end of the dog, and the snout here. It's very clear in this. And you have a figure probably representing Dalí's nursemaid sits here. There's like a little pond of water which represents a fish. And as you get close up to seeing the images, let me just go ahead a little bit. Okay, I just wanted to go over this. The spatial frame is doubled to read as both a restricted area of still life and a more expansive space of landscape. The dog eyes tunnels through the rocks and the collar is an aqueduct. We'll look at it closer. Below the muzzle is a cavalry scene recalling Leonardo da Vinci's Wizard by sea battles and stained walls. A woman's face, a group of figures with children, with a child, a duplication of fruit bowl, Annette Mender, all these things will be pointed out to you. And then the head in the dead center. So we'll go back. And we're going to start on this side over here. We'll get a close up of it. Thanks, Peter. Here we have the eye, which is actually an opening in the rock. And kind of the sandy walkway comes down here, and the water of the pond.
there's the aqueducts. Here we have trees. Here we have a face. And then you have these figures on horseback, or cavalry scene. Then you have some more figures here. And so just, you know, what was amazing to me is to discover all these things that you look closely at this work. But first you're going to see, you know, the face, but there's so much going on. It's just incredible. You have this wonderful figure here leaning on a rock wall, a stone rock wall. And then you have another figure here. And you have a figure that's kind of kneeling down. It's hard to see here. And it has like a crutch, and the knee is kind of bony. Like right here, there's a bone coming out of it. It's sort of creepy. And then a child standing here. And then you have what looks like an individual, a black individual standing here in full form with partial nudity. And a cloth hanging over. Poles being out of the wall. And then down here you have, again, that little compotier with, well, they almost look like birds, but they are a little one with the pedestal. And then you have the nursemaid. And also here, which you might not see offhand, is a nude woman. This is a little closer to the face. You can see here that here's that nude woman over here, and there's another figure next to her. There's a child laying down. There's a pot or jug laying down to make this eye, so you have an eye and an eye. And then you have the amphora here again. And then this is the next one. See a little bit more. Where you see another figure here, which may be the net mender or the nursemaid again, with figures standing next to her in a basket. So all these things are incorporated into this painting. Quite incredible. Endless Enigma, 1938. This is probably the granddaddy of the enigmas that he did, because there's six images that appear in this. And so he must have taken some time to figure out what he was going to do with this. And it appeared that it remained in the collection and was never sold because it ended up in Madrid. So we have the first figure is the philosopher, and you can see it here, and here it is here. There's the arm and the head. Next figure, not showing up real well, is the hound, greyhound here, and you can see the greyhound, here's the head, and the torso coming back here. And the next one, which is the still life of mandolin and fruit and bowl. See, this is supposed to be the mandolin fruit. So you have, you're using this as the fruit bowl, and the mandolin is here on the tabletop with the landscape in the back. And then the next one is the boat and a fishing net on a beach. So it interprets the what you just did as a still life to another kind of arrangement. Based on the same things. And then you have the mythical beast. And that's right here. That's a little rock formation, and it comes down a little bizarre. And then you have just the one-eyed cyclops right there. Dalí wrote on his Julian Levy catalog in 1939. I already read this to you, but I can't remember. Of a cubist picture, one asks, what does that represent? Of a surrealist picture, one sees what it represents, but one asks, what does it mean? Of a paranoid picture, one asks abundantly, what do I see? What does that represent? What does that mean? This came out at the time that that painting was displayed. And he actually talks about Leonardo da Vinci and this also, and, you know, looking at, you know, the different things and how Leonardo talked about that. Of course, this was done at the time of when he did the that shows each and every one of those creatures so that the individual who got this catalog, and they're depicted along here too, but they kind of faded out and then I did the slide. Each of these kind of, you know, are overlaid so you can see these images, and that's how the catalog was produced. And this is how it's described. Of course, he spelled mandolin with an I and Y, fruit dish with pears, two figs on table, mythological beast, face with a great one-eyed moron, he calls it, greyhound, reclining figure, beach of acreous, seated woman, mending sails, seen from the back, and boat. And that's how it's described in the catalog in 1939. The transparent simulacrum of the famed image. Here's Dalí getting in over here. Checking out what he's doing these days, I guess, I don't know. Here we have a tabletop. This is very subtle. You have a little dish here, which becomes a little inlet bay here, and then you have the pears, the pears here. This is very subtle as compared to some of the other ones, which are very complex. And then we have the invisible Afghan with the apparition on the beach of the face of Garcia Lorca in the form of a fruit dish with three figs. And here's the Afghan hound. You can see the legs coming down, which are actually figs. Then you have the fruit dish, poor Garcia Lorca's face. And then you have the figures, one reclining, just seated here. Here's the leg, here's the leg, here's the leg. So he's still working with that idea. And we have the mountain lake. Subtle depiction of this pond or lake that was found on a mountain lake was up in the mountains. And so he depicts it as a fish laying on the table because this looks like gills. And he has sort of this kind of Madonna shape, which appeared earlier in one of the horse women paintings. And of course, the telephone and the things that went on with the conversations. And then the impressions of Africa. This particular painting was done in Rome when he was staying there. Also, the Spanish Civil War was still going on, and they were going from one place to the other to kind of seek refuge. They couldn't stay in Spain. But it didn't stop Dalí from painting. He continued to paint some beautiful works during this time. He stayed at the house of Lord Berners. He was a friend of Edward James, and Edward James was one of their big patrons. He was a British gentleman, and he bought most of Dalí's works during the 1937-1938 period. And so they moved around, staying in hotels and at their high society friends at the time. So that's where they were taking refuge. You have Dalí depicted in this with, in the foreground, really strong portrait of himself at an easel. And this is supposed to represent a Baroque cloth. And it was during the 16th, 17th century influence that he was receiving while he was spending time in Rome and traveling to Sicily and places like that, that he was very inspired. But what's really interesting is that there's some of the other things in this painting. Let's see if I just said something about it. I've talked about the taking the refuge. So the background, there are several images that appear across the back. And you have the donkey's head. Then you have a figure standing here, and it may be hard for y'all to see, maybe I'll just move it up and you can look at it closer. And then some figures standing next to it. You have a gentleman here, I'm squatting down, I think he's defecating. And that's not unusual, I know. You can buy, I don't know if you people know about Cabernet and Cabernets, but you can buy them in the shops around there, and it depicts images or people or poopy. And so this is supposed to be, you come from Earth, you return to Earth, and they put up a sign in the Tiffany scenes. So it's a very traditional element. You come upstairs, you'll find a lot of them on shelves around. Between our staff up there that's experienced the common experience. Here, next to that, and of course, these seem to be like African or figures or relate back to this Moorish heritage. So you have those kind of figures standing here, and you have this wonderful portrait of Gala composed of the openings or the windows of the building behind her. And then you have figures kind of hidden here. But as you go to the other side, you have some other kind of mysterious figures. You have this man standing there with a vest on, but his head is really made up of the rocks behind him. Then you have a figure of a woman in a dress, which seems sort of reminiscent of a portrait that Dalí did. But the hole in the rock becomes her head. And then they're all kind of tied together with these, you know, the poles, like in the Enchanted Beach. And then you have another figure seated in the boat, which is playing a guitar, it appears, or a mandolin. So these images are all populated in the background. And this image here seems to be also done, either a pheasant or a turkey, a dead turkey, because his head is kind of hanging down over here, which you don't normally see, and it's tied into the rocks here. So it, you know, becomes part of the rocks and part of the landscape and part of the still image that it would create. So they're wonderful images. And the final one I have from 1939, Dancer and Skull, and there were other things that he did. He did, you know, washes and watercolors and other, like Mae West even during this time. If anybody remembers the Mae West portrait in the room, that was a gouache, so that's why it's not in this group. But he was working on other interpretations of the double image. Here he has the ballet dancer, which is kind of a weird combination of images, because you have the skull, the teeth here, then you have this little ballet dancer here, her choo-choo becomes the skirt, the teeth. And her arms seem to be up behind her head. So that is my visual illusions for you all.